tonight, I am actually going to share with something with you that I've been wanting to share for a long, long time. We're going to travel quite a bit today, and we're going to look at a lot of slides, so we have to move quickly. Is that okay with everyone? You know, they tell me I talk too fast, so if I do, then just speed up your listening device or do whatever you need to do. All right, let's... really quick, just so you know, the poll questions. Can I see yours really quick? Don't worry, I'm not going to look at what yours said. So the poll, let's hide that. The poll question, we're actually collecting these at the end. So we hope that everyone, every night we actually want to take a poll question. So we're going to collect these at the end. You don't put your name on this one. You put your name on the, you have your name, the name tag already. So hopefully we'll have the rest of the registration, and we'll be showing you part of the rest of the schedule at the end of the meeting tonight. So we're very excited for that. We have a lot of topics we want to talk about. So let's pray and let's move quickly. Father in heaven, I thank you so very, very much, because I believe that in the midst of our crises in life, in the midst of our suffering, you promise to be there. You've said in your word that you will never leave us nor forsake us. So I pray, Lord, just now that your presence will be sensed in this room, that we will know that you are here. You are here for us. Help us, Lord, to find hope this evening. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. The other night I mentioned that I love going to the British Museum, and I've been wanting to show you a picture. This is a picture the very first time of the British Museum. The first time I went to the British Museum. So as you can see, it's quite a beautiful structure just in and of itself. And I mentioned to you that you go into the British Museum, you go past the main lobby area, and once you get past the lobby, then you see this beautiful atrium. I mean, it's just very beautiful. It's pure glass on top, and so it lights up the entire structure. And when the first time I went, they had an exhibit on Babylon. And so I was just like, oh, I got to see this. I've got to see this. I quickly tried to figure out where the Babylonian exhibit was, and I apparently went to the wrong area. But then I found it, only to discover it was closed. So I'm sorry you're not going to see anything from the Babylonian exhibit this evening, but I'm going to take you somewhere else. Now, as you can see, there are actually steps that lead up, these steps lead up, and in this center, this whole building in the center is actually the British Museum Library. And it holds some of the largest collection of old and ancient writings. So they have a lot of the Babylonian writings are there. Some of the things that we've talked about, historians, a lot of their old writings are housed here in the British Museum. One of these days, I'm going to have to take you to the Louvre, huh? You guys like the Louvre? It's the largest museum in the world, the Louvre. The largest collection of Egyptian archaeology. Very, very famous Egyptologist. But here in the British Museum, when you enter, remember what I said earlier, a few days ago. Wow, we're moving along, huh? Friday night, I mentioned that if you go into the British Museum, you turn left, right? Just like the bathroom. So once again, if you need to use the bathroom, go out the door, turn left and left, okay? So just, we got that out of the way. Okay, so we're going to turn left. We're not going to go up the stairs. We're going to turn left. There's this beautiful statue there, but we're going to turn left and go this way. And over there is where we find the release from Lachish, or Lachish, depending on how you pronounce it. But my wife and I, we actually excavated in Lachish. And so that's where we were just in 2014. And so I want to show you some pictures from Lachish. They excavated this quite some time ago. This was the main gate going into Lachish. And as you went up into Lachish, you would enter through this gate. And as you notice, where is the wall? The wall is on what side as you're going up? As you're going up? Your right side. Very good. Yeah, your other left. So, all right, it's on your right side. And there was a reason for this. There was a reason for this. When military personnel would come to attack a city, most people are what? They're right-handed. And so if they were going to attack with their sword or with their sling. You wanted to make sure that they weren't able to just come up and attack. They would have to hit their arm against the wall if they had a large crowd. And so they would have battering rams. And I'm going to show you pictures of a battering rams today. But this is a view of a battering ramp that they built. The Assyrians built this. And we're going to look at that story tonight. The Assyrians built this battering ram that would go up, and their goal was to get up into Lachish. That was their goal. Now, I mentioned the other night that Lachish was the second most important military city in all of Israel. What was number one? Jerusalem. So this is an extremely important city, right? It's like number two. Now, I'm going to try to show you an aerial view. This is the area where my wife and I excavated, okay? Just up here, back there, actually. This is the palace. Over here is that wall. Do you see how big that wall is? It's quite a wall. And my wife and I, we would park. There we go. We would park over here. And we would walk the mile and a half or 2 miles around the mound every morning at about 3 a.m. You know why? Because you do not want to be excavating in the afternoon. Temperatures reached over 105 degrees that summer. Yeah, 41 Celsius is not my friend. Yeah, it's like Arizona. Just like Arizona. How many of you work outside? You know. Anyway, this is an aerial view of Lachish. We're going to move around. This is called Tel Lachish. Now, a tel means that it's a mound. And so a mound means that once they would build a city, and that city would be destroyed, and then they would just pack on that city, and then they would build another city. And then if that city got destroyed, they would pack on that city, and they would build a city. And eventually it becomes this big mound. So the word tel simply means a mound. Okay? You know a good way to remember that? Tell it on the mountain, okay? Tell it on the mountain. All right. So this is the main gate, and you can see as the Assyrians, they wanted to come up this, okay? Sorry, aerial photography there. But they wanted to come up this area, this battering ram. They were trying to build a battering ram that would come up here because that was the main gate to get into this fortified city. Now I'm going to show you a picture here. I hope I don't get in trouble. But we excavated with the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. We also excavated with Harvard University. And the largest group was from a school named Southern Adventist University. They have an archaeology program there. It's the only biblical archaeology undergraduate program in all of the United States. So we went with them and with Princeton and a few others like that, you know, some of those schools. Anyway, I'm going to show you the area that I excavated, just in case you don't think I'm legit. So we excavated, so this was the road to get to the back. That was the main road we walked up. And this is, so in the daytime, when it started getting hot, we would put a huge covering. And we would hope that it didn't blow over. And if it didn't blow over, sometimes the poles would fall. I remember on a few occasions, they were large poles. And if the wind moved up, the pole would come down and smack. Man. Poor ladies. Two of them got hurt. Anyway, these are called squares. Do you know why they're called squares? Exactly. Man, you guys are really good at this. I think you could do this. I think you could do this. I really think you could. So we excavated. So I was in this square. I was in square that one. My wife was in that one. Apparently, they say if you put a married couple in a square too often, too much, too long, too hot of the day, they don't get along. I don't know. Have you ever heard things like this? You ever heard things like that? I said, we love each other. We love each other. They said, oh, we've experimented with this. We've been doing this for a long time. We know. You need your space every now and then. So anyway, I was in this square, and after only digging a few feet, here's a picture. After only digging a few feet, you can see how deep we were getting. This was the top of a wall. And that's really exciting. That's really exciting because we actually found the wall, the outer wall, to the other side of this city. And it's really cool because in the wall is where people lived. People actually would have their homes within the walls of Jerusalem. So have you ever read the story of the Battle of Jericho? And Rahab, you remember what she had? She let out that curtain or that yeah, scarlet cord or whatever, out the window. It was out of the wall, which was also her house. Okay, so people lived in the walls or part of the wall. Anyway, the other thing that was not cool about it is once you hit a wall, you hit a wall. And you've kind of ended excavation because my square about all of this was a wall. So they ended up moving me. They felt bad. I didn't find anything. And then somebody found something where I was digging. And then they moved me. And then somebody else found something where I was digging because they moved me again. And they did this about 5 times. So everyone found everything that I was digging for. But you got to love those walls, man. Anyway, it was very exciting. They recently are still in the process of publishing the rest of these. So I can't show you any of the artifacts. I'm sorry about that. But there is something else that's very interesting about the city of Lachish. And so we're going to go through that story today. We go back to the British Museum. This is called, this is a mural, and it was carved into stone, into rock. And this was found in the palace of Sennacherib in the capital city of the Assyrians, which was known as, can anyone guess what the capital city of the Assyrians was? No. Huh? Nineveh. Very, very good. Have you ever heard, there was this guy who got swallowed up by a big fish. You maybe have heard of him, Jonah, you know, belly of the whale for 3 days kind of story. I'm going to show you today why he was scared of the Assyrians. We're going to see that today. All right. Here's the story. 2 Kings chapter 18. If you have your Bible, I want to invite you. We're going to spend quite a bit of time in 2 Kings chapter 18 and chapter 19. I've got most of the verses on the screen. We're going to move quickly. It's quite a lengthy story, but just know that you can find the entire story in 2 Kings chapter 18 and 2 Kings chapter 19. There are also other places in Isaiah and also in Jeremiah. So this story is mentioned in multiple places. This is not an isolated story. In the 14th year of King Hezekiah, Sennacherib, king of Assyria, came up against all the fortified cities of Judah and took them. How many cities? All of them. So remember that. There are at least 48 fortified cities. So imagine that. He's coming up city after city after city. And these aren't just, you know, out there cities. These are fortified cities. So they are made to withstand the battles of war. So keep that in mind. He comes up to every single one. As for Hezekiah the Jew, he did not submit. This is the Assyrian annals. Okay, so now we're coming from the Assyrian side. He did not submit to my yoke. I laid siege to 46 of his strong cities, not 48, 46 of his strong cities, walled forts, and to the countless small villages, and conquered them by means of well-stamped earth ramps and battering rams near the walls, combined with the attack of foot soldiers. I drove out 200,150 people, young and old, male and female. Himself I made a prisoner in Jerusalem, his royal residence, like a bird in a cage. Pretty boastful. Let's remember this, okay? We're going to move along. 2 Kings. So now we're going from the biblical side. Then the king of Assyria sent the Tartan, the Rabsarius, and Rabshakeh from Lachish with a great army against Jerusalem to King Hezekiah. And they went up and came to Jerusalem. So now where are they? They're at Jerusalem. They're no longer at Lachish. They're leaving Lachish. They're going to Jerusalem. This is what they say. Then Rabshakeh stood and called out with a loud voice in Hebrew. So this way everyone could hear. Because you remember, the Hebrews lived in Jerusalem. So everyone is hearing it in the Hebrew tongue saying, "Hear the word of the great king, the king of Assyria. Thus says the king, do not let Hezekiah deceive you, for he shall not be able to deliver you from his hand, nor let Hezekiah make you trust in the Lord, saying, the Lord will surely deliver us. This city shall not be given into the hand of the king of Assyria. Do not listen to Hezekiah, for thus says the king of Assyria, make peace with me by a present. Come out to me, and every one of you eat of his own vine, and every one of his own fig tree, and every one of you drink the waters of his own cisterns, until I come and take you away to a land like your own." You remember what God called the land of Israel? The land flowing with milk and honey. Remember how he described that to the people, the Israelites, when they were trying to flee out of Egypt? Very interesting. A land of grain and new wine, a land of bread and vineyards, a land of olive groves and honey, that you may live and not die. But do not listen to Hezekiah, lest he persuade you, saying, The Lord will deliver us. How many times has he said, don't listen to Hezekiah? Very interesting. Has any of the gods of the nations, now he's asking a very important question. Everyone is listening to this. Has any of the gods of the nations at all delivered its land from the hand of the king of Syria? Who among all the gods of the land have delivered their countries from my hand, that the Lord should deliver Jerusalem from my hand? Imagine this. They have come from the north, the northeast. They're coming in. They've conquered every single tribe that they have come up against. Every single country, every single fortified city, every small village, every young and old child. They have taken away literally over 200,000 of them. And he's asking the question, who's been able to stop me? None of the gods, not even yours, will stop me. And he's able to make this bold assertion because now he is literally at the capital city. Imagine a terrorist attack going to Washington, D.C. They have come up to the Capitol building. Don't imagine this too much. You know, this probably goes online somewhere. I get in trouble. Imagine them getting to the capital city of Washington, D.C. And they're able to say, no nation has been able to stop us. No nation out there. The greatest nations of the world have not been able to stop us. You will not either. You will not either. That's how serious this was. That's how serious this was. The story continues. And so it was, when King Hezekiah heard it, that he tore his clothes, covered himself with sackcloth, and went into the house of the Lord. Then he sent Eliakim to Isaiah the prophet. Isaiah the prophet. And Isaiah said to them, thus says the Lord, do not be afraid of the words which you have heard, with which the servants of the king of Assyria have blasphemed me. Surely I will send a spirit among them, and he shall hear a rumor and return to his own land, and I will cause him to fall by a sword in his own land. Look, you have heard what the kings of Assyria have done to all the lands by utterly destroying them, and shall you be delivered? Now we're in the next chapter, 19, verse 11. This is their response. This is Sennacherib's response. And how does God's speaker respond? Have the gods of the nations delivered those whom my fathers have destroyed? Gozan and Haran and Resef and the people of Eden who were in Telassar? Have they been able to stop me? Where is the king of Hamath, the king of Arphad, the king of the city of Seraphim, Henna and Iva? None of them have been able to stop me. Where are they? Hezekiah goes up to the Lord, spreads now this message before the Lord. Then Hezekiah prayed before the Lord, and this is what he says. This is an incredible prayer. Incredible prayer. O Lord God of Israel, the one who dwells between the cherubim, you are God. You alone, of all the kingdoms of the earth, you have made heaven and earth. Incline your ear, O Lord, and hear. Open your eyes, O Lord, and see and hear the words of Sennacherib, which he has sent to reproach the living God. Truly, Lord, the kings of Assyria have laid waste and nations and their lands. Now, therefore, O Lord God, I pray thee, save us from his hand, that all the nations of the earth may know that you are the Lord God, you alone. You alone. Then Isaiah, the son of Amos, sent to Hezekiah, saying, thus says the Lord God of Israel, because you have prayed to me against Sennacherib, king of Assyria, what did he do? I have heard. I have heard. My friends, when we pray the Lord, he hears. I want to assure you, if nothing else, know God hears your prayers. God is listening. He sees your agony. He sees your situation. He knows what you're going through. He knows your pain. God sees it all. God sees it all. Therefore, thus says the Lord concerning the king of Assyria, he shall not come into this city. Where are they? Where are they? Jerusalem, right? They're in Jerusalem. Remember that. He shall not come into this city, nor shoot an arrow in there, nor come before it with a shield, nor build a siege mount against it. By the way that he came, by the same shall he return. And he shall not come into this city, says the Lord. For I will defend this city to save it for my own sake and for my servant David's sake. Incredible. Incredible. Are you ready to see? Are you ready to see what happened? This is incredible. My wife, she was working in Paris. She's not here, so I can tell you all the stories now. I just want you to know, I wouldn't lie, so my version is the right one. Okay? Just remember that. It could be. It could be. Let's not spread any rumors. Anyway, my wife was working in Paris. She was doing an internship there at the American College in Paris. And so I was a missionary, in fact, and I she wasn't my wife yet. But I knew she was supposed to be. You know, I knew that. So she wasn't at that stage yet. But, you know, I know these things. And so I decided it was good for me to take a trip to see her. And so I flew to Paris. I've been to Paris a few times. I actually had a speaking engagement there, and so it worked out quite well. I spoke in a church there in Paris. And then I said, have you ever been to London? You know, if you take the bullet train to London, it's only a few hours. You can get there very quickly. You go under the channel, the English Channel. So it's incredible. You go very fast. So we went to London, and I took her, and these are some of the pictures I took. See, so I want you to know I sacrificed part of my date for you guys, okay? Okay, just remember that. Just remember that. That's how serious I am about these things. Okay, so we were in London, and these are some of the pictures I took. To the right is King Sennacherib, and he is telling people that they need to submit. They need to submit to him. In fact, here's a larger picture, so you can see. So you can see, people are to come to Sennacherib, and they are to give homage to him. They are to give homage to him. So you can see all these different people are coming to Sennacherib, and they're paying him tributes. Hezekiah was one of the people who used to pay Sennacherib tributes. And if you actually read through 2 Kings chapter 18, you recognize that Hezekiah said, you know what, I'm not going to do this anymore. I'm not going to do this anymore. And so that's why Sennacherib said, if you're not going to do this, then we're going to come against you. And so they started doing that. They started coming against them. And so I'll show you a few more of these images. You can see these people are coming to the king, and they're bowing. They're giving allegiance to the king Sennacherib. They're giving allegiance to him. The Assyrians are quite impressive. Just so you know, I'm a really tall guy. And I come to about here, okay? So these are quite ornate structures. This is what you would see when you entered into the gates of Assyria. And so this is now going, you'd see things like this. The Assyrians were very famous for their warfare. Their warfare. They were very famous for their warfare. Oh, there we go. Little repeat there. Are we going backwards? What am I doing? There we are. All right, now we're moving forward. You can see all of them have weapons. They're going up. And this is actually a depiction of them going up to the famous city of Lachish. Each one of these, this is taken from the palace. It's 8 feet tall, each one of these, 8 feet tall, and the entire thing was over 80 feet long. 80 feet long. That's quite some length. 80 feet long. And so they're giving homage to Sennacherib. One of the things, like I said, they were known for their warfare. They were merciless. They were merciless. They were known for attacking lions. In fact, they even have depictions of them having hand-to-hand combat with lions. I don't know if you can imagine that. I don't know if you can imagine that. That's quite a task there. Here's one. Hand-to-hand combat with a lion.
Ferocious.
They were, you can understand a little bit why Jonah was like, Lord, I'm not sure about this. You know, going to Nineveh, that's like the capital of the military power of the world. This is a little hard to see, but there's a lot of these. It looks like trees. It looks like trees. What those actually are, those are not trees. They're actually torches. And what they're doing is they're torching the fields so that nobody could eat. They were merciless. And I don't know if you remember earlier when we were having that aerial view over Lachish, you could see fields just outside of Lachish. And so it was a very agrarian, did I say that right? Agricultural society. There we go. We'll use that. That one works. Anyway, you could see the arrows. There's descriptions of, you remember that story? There's a guy in the Bible. He's mentioned more than anyone else, including Jesus. His name is David. David, he had a sling. You remember reading that story, sling, David Goliath story? Incredible story. But what's interesting about that is the tribe of the Benjaminites, he didn't come from the tribe of the Benjaminites, but it describes that the tribe of the Benjaminites could actually throw a sling. They're about this big, that ball that they would hold. They would put it in their sling, and as they released, they could actually go a distance of 200 yards. Within a hair's breadth accuracy. That's not an exaggeration, by the way. They actually have discovered literally thousands of these small stones going up against this fortified city of Lachish, going up against them. You can see their arrows. You remember what God said? This is incredible. Do you remember what God said? God said, not even an arrow will go into this city. Not even an arrow. But where did the arrows go? Where are we? We're looking at Lachish. This is from the palace in Nineveh. And so they're going up against the walled cities of Lachish. There's just so many pictures. These are battering rams. These are battering rams. So you can see they got shields in front of them. You can see even those small balls that they're trying to throw, like they would throw in a sling. So these are realistic depictions. Realistic depictions. What does the Lord say? And it came to pass on a certain night that the angel of the Lord went out and killed in the camp of the Assyrians 185,000. And when people arose early in the morning, there were the corpses all dead. The story actually continues. It says what happened to Sennacherib. It says, so Sennacherib, king of Assyria, departed and went away, returned home, and remained where? What is the city that Sennacherib went up against? He went up against Jerusalem. But what is the city that is depicted in his palace? Lachish. He does not depict Jerusalem because he never gets into Jerusalem. Not even an arrow. And how do we know that? One, because of what's depicted. And ancients never depict failure. They never depict failure. So his most successive battle was against the second most important city in Lachish, which is Lachish. It's not Jerusalem. This is incredible, my friends. Sennacherib's prison. If you ever get to go to Chicago, I don't like their pizza. I'm more into New York style. If you ever get to go to Chicago, go to the Oriental Institute of Archaeology at the University of Chicago. This is where Sennacherib's prism is. You can go there, you can see this, and on Sennacherib's prism, he details the attacks that he made. And he says, this is where he says, I shut him up like a bird in a cage in Jerusalem. He doesn't mention that he didn't do anything else in Jerusalem. In fact, the rock records say that he went home, his son killed him, and he died in Nineveh. He never made it past the walls of Jerusalem. It is incredible. My friends, I believe that God is speaking to us today about hope. Thousands of years ago, in a land far away, in a desert similar to ours, God showed that He is still mighty, that He still can be trusted. The rock record speaks the same. By the way that he came, by the same shall he return. And he shall not come into this city, says the Lord. For I will defend this city to save it for my own sake and for my servant David's sake. The Bible is speaking to us that we can trust the Lord. In the midst of the crises that we are facing in life, we can trust the Lord. In fact, the Bible depicts that at the end of time, there will be a day and age such as there never was before. The Bible says that there is going to be a battle called Armageddon. And there will be a fight between good and evil. We're going to talk about that next week. You got to come. You don't want to miss these things. We're going to talk about the Bible of Armageddon. I've studied Hebrew. It's a Hebrew word, har, Megiddo. But I've been to Megiddo, in fact. Maybe I should show you a picture of that. But the Bible describes that in the same book that it talks about the Battle of Armageddon, there was a battle that took place literally thousands of years before. This battle took place in heaven. If you have your Bible, please turn with me to Revelation chapter 12. Revelation chapter 12, the Bible describes that there was a battle in heaven. And in this battle, there was a war. Can you imagine a war in heaven? That does not sound like heaven. That does not sound like heaven. But the Bible says in verse 7, and there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against a dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. No. Ahead of myself. No more place in heaven. Where do they go? Where does Satan and his angels now go? The Bible says, so the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. They're now on planet earth. And when God created the world, he created it beautiful and perfect. There was not a single taint of sin in the world. It was a beautiful garden. There in the Garden of Eden, it was incredible. There was four rivers that ran through it. They had the river of the water. I mean, it was just an incredible place. God would come there and he would meet with them in the cool of the day. And just an incredible description. You got to read the Bible, man. Genesis chapter 2? Oh, man. That's the kind of place I want to live in. But we know what happens. Eve met this serpent at a tree. She really shouldn't have been spending any time there. She had a conversation with somebody she shouldn't have been having a conversation with. And do you remember what happened? The Bible tells us what happened. She ended up eating of the fruit, and she committed what we call sin. And the Bible tells us what happens when we commit sin. It says, but your iniquities. Now, I want you to know what the word iniquities mean. The word iniquities means a known sin. You know it's wrong, and yet you do it. You know people like that? I'll tell you, when I was a kid, I want you to know I was innocent, okay? I don't know why you're laughing. But there are times I would do things, and it wasn't the right thing. You know, it wasn't the right thing. It wasn't the right thing. It wasn't the best thing, according to my mom. But she would tell me what something was, and if something was wrong, what do? Say, I'm sorry. Say, I'm sorry. He says, God says, but your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hid his face from you so that he will not hear. What happens? Now that she is separated from God, she is separated from the source of life. The Bible tells us in several instances that God is the source of life. Jesus said, I have come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. And so when we are separated from the source of life, we're separated from God. We're separated from God. And what is the eventual result of being separated from the source of life? Death, right? Death. It's incredible. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And when we fall short, man, we fall really short. We fall really short. The Bible tells us what happens because we've fallen short. The wages of sin is death. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's an amen moment. It's an amen moment. Romans chapter 6, verse 23, the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So even though you might be separated because of your sin, Christ steps in and bridges the gap. It's incredible. Christ is incredible. Jesus is incredible. God says to us, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn from your evil ways. For why should you die, O house of Israel? Why should you die? God's purpose in life is calling us back to himself. That is the whole reason that Jesus came to the earth, to call us back to himself. So what do we have to do? What do we do if we've been separated from God? Maybe you've been separated. Maybe you know in your heart you've been separated. Maybe it's a little separation. Maybe it's not a great chiasm. Maybe you've got a separation the size of the Grand Canyon. God can still bridge that gap. There's no canyon too big for God. God's the biggest person I know. He's also the oldest person I know. But notice this. The first thing we have to do is believe. We must believe that there is a God. We must believe that there is a God that we can trust, a God that we can have confidence in, a God who says what he says will actually come to pass. We must believe that there is a God. We must believe God's word. We must believe that that's the most important instruction that he could give to us. I heard somebody once say that the Bible is basic instructions before leaving earth. My friends, we must believe. The Bible tells us, so they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household. We must believe the Lord. We must believe his word. The second thing we need to do is we need to repent. We need to repent. When we've done something wrong, the right thing to do is to say, I'm sorry. And it's not enough to say, I'm sorry. You know, I remember when I was a child. I don't know if you guys have a mother like this. You know, Asian moms, I got to say this with care. I got to say this with care. My mom once told me when I did something wrong as a child, if you're really sorry, anyone can fill this in? You got the same Asian mom, man, I'm telling you. Maybe it's a Filipino thing. If you're really sorry, you won't do it. Oh, you all got like Asian moms, huh? You won't do it again. You won't do it again. Repentance is like a U-turn. I remember I was visiting the Philippines. I was speaking out there, and we were going into the countryside. And I remember going into this countryside. I was speaking at some school, and as I was going there, I was like, whoa, this road is beautiful. I was sitting in the back seat of this truck, and the wind was just blowing in my face. I was just taking it in. It was incredible. Just incredible. You know, the Philippines that I left is not the Philippines that I was coming back to, and the roads were beautiful now. It wasn't like the roads in Tucson, but it was beautiful. And then all of a sudden, as we're getting onto this road, all of a sudden, and I realized the roads were not the same anymore. They were like how it was when I came the first time. You know what I'm talking about? Nobody? All right. Drive down I-19 just recently. Anyway, I remember thinking to myself, we're going there, and I realized something on the journey to the school. Oh, man, what if I forgot something? There was only one road to the school. They were way out in the back country, man. Only one road in, and only one road out. My friends, repentance is like a U-turn. If you're going in the wrong direction, make a U-turn in your life. Turn around. Return back to the Lord. The Bible says, repent therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so that the times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. As Acts chapter 16, verse 31. We need to believe. We need to repent. We need to believe that God can be trusted. We need to return back to the Lord. We need to repent of our ways. The truth is, the Bible is very clear. All of us have fallen short of the glory of God. All of us. All of us. What's number three? Number three is we need to confess. We need to confess. You know, it's not just one thing to acknowledge for yourself that you are wrong. And the truth is, God knows. He sees all. Just like he saw all that was happening in Sennacherib's life, he sees all that's happening in our own lives. He sees all that was happening in Hezekiah's life. And the Bible describes it. Hezekiah laid himself before the Lord. He laid himself before the Lord. He believed his word. And he moved forward. We need to confess. The Bible tells me this. It says in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us. Imagine this. Some of us need some more cleansing than others. I'm one of them, you know. The Lord wants to cleanse every part of us. You know, if the Lord's going to clean me up, I don't want him to do a botched job, you know. I want him to be thorough. If I'm taking my car to get a car wash, I want them to do a good job, you know? I'm paying money for that. My friends, Jesus paid it all so that he could completely clean all of us up. He paid it all. to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. There's a fourth step. You know, a lot of us forget this fourth step. Sometimes we think that the only thing that we need to do is we need to believe, and then we need to repent, and then we need to confess. But the truth is, we also need to receive. We need to receive Jesus into our lives. We need to receive the Holy Spirit into our lives, because it is the reception of Jesus into the life that will transform the life to be like Jesus. We can only be more like Him as we allow more of Him in. It's incredible. The Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 3, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if any man will open the door, hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him, and he with me." My friends, Jesus wants to come into your heart tonight. Jesus wants to come into your life, and he wants to transform you. He wants you to know that you can believe his word, that you can trust him in the trials of life, in the crises that we're facing as a planet. Christ can be trusted. Christ can be trusted. He is knocking on the door of every one of our hearts, and he is waiting. He is asking the question, "Can I come in? Can I come into your heart? Can I do the thing that only I can do?" You know, many of us, we live under the notion that we can change ourselves. And you know, the truth is that's not a Christian thing. The Christian thing is recognizing we can't change ourselves. That's what it is. It's recognizing that we need somebody greater outside of ourselves, and that greater person is God. Who's greater than God? Who's greater than God? Nobody is greater than God. Nobody's greater than Jesus. It's somebody outside of us who is able to come in and to transform us. He's able to come in. And that's why the Bible tells us, let's see if I can get this here, going through a few of these, "For it is God who works in you." Who works? And where does he work? In you. It's not us working in us. It's God. It's allowing God to come into our lives. "For it is God who works in you, both to will and to do for his good pleasure." Not my pleasure. You might not like my pleasure all the time. I know, I'm a very pleasurable person. I'm a kind, you know, kind-hearted. No one's greater than God, my friends. "For it is him who desires to work in our lives, to will and to do of his good pleasure." That is his desire. He wants to come in. He wants to give you hope in the midst of your crisis. He wants to give you hope in the midst of your suffering, in the midst of your pain. Christ hears your cry. Christ sees your agony. Christ knows like no other. Only Christ knows. It's incredible. It's incredible. The Bible describes this for us. It gives us hope even in the midst of our trials. Even in the midst of our trials. Several years ago, Sir Ernest Shackleton wanted to take him and his crew to go and be the first people to go across the Antarctic. So he ventured onto this adventure. They traveled on this ship. This ship had boarded onto Antarctica. But you know what happened? You know what Antarctica is like, right? No? It's kind of cold. You know? You know, Tucson, they don't know what cold is here. My wife's from Canada. They know cold. Called her up one time. She said it's negative 40 outside. You know what negative 40 is? Negative 40 is cold. That's what it is. Negative 40 is when Celsius and Fahrenheit meet. They meet at negative 40. Negative 40. They were in Antarctica. They landed, but they got stuck. Over the night, the water froze around them, and now they were trapped. They were trapped. They had been there for quite some time. Their food supply was beginning to run low. Their food supply was beginning to run low. So Shackleton took 8 members of his crew and boarded a small ship. Let's see, there we go. They went to sail to the closest island that they could. It was 830 miles away. They went. They went. They were gone. They were gone now. They were gone. The process took them months. 1 month passed. 2 months passed. Shackleton told his crew, the last words he told his crew is, "I will come back. I will return for you." It was now 3 months. Their food supply was running to its end. They now hit 4 months. Delirious, cold, and quite literally freezing cold. Now they were there. 4 months. Shackleton arrived. They were saved. They were saved. My friends, the Bible tells us that one day Jesus is coming back. He has said, "I am coming again. I am coming again." And Jesus extends his hand out to us and he asks us, "Will you come home with me? Will you join me? Will you join me?"
Me, Lord, of all my silly sad charades, how I long to be all and only yours. Take away the clutter in my life every day and make me like a child at play. Joy. I love to laugh and cry with you. You've become a friend with me all the time. Help me to be patient as I watch and as I pray, growing in your love each day. Lord, show me the way. When the time comes, I want him to know me. When the time comes, I want to be there. When the time comes, I want to be ready. When Jesus comes to take me, take me home. Fill me, Lord. I want your love to overflow, running free through me to a lonely world. Let me share that simple truth that sets people free. How I want them all to see. Take me home.
My friends, I believe that Jesus is coming soon. And I believe that when the time comes, you're going to want to be ready. You're going to want to be ready. I want to invite you tonight in a special way to make a decision. It's a decision that begins now and it goes till eternity. And that decision is simple. It simply says, Lord, I want to believe you. Lord, I want to trust you. Lord, I want to begin a journey with you that will take me from here to heaven. Would you like to begin that journey tonight? Would you like to say, Lord, I want to be ready. I want to be ready. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I thank you so very much. I thank you because you have given us evidence in archaeology and in history. But most importantly, Lord, you have given us evidence in your word that we can trust you, that we can believe you. So I pray, Lord, that whatever there is in our life that might separate us from you, that we'll hand that over to you. Just now, Lord, we give it to you and we ask that you will take that and that you'll work in our lives, that you'll cleanse us and make us like Jesus. Lord, we want to be ready. We want to be ready. Make us ready, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.